Talking about super resolution and so what super resolution is, how we can do it or how you can do it, and what does it actually enabling us all to do. And with that, before we really turn to super resolution, we need to talk first actually about what resolution is. And resolution is basically the ability to resolve two objects and to separate them from each other, like these two dots in this slide. And this dot could be actually a GFP molecule. And we all know that a GFP molecule can be excited, for example, with a blue laser light, and it emits in a green photons back due to the Stokes shift. And we know that when light of a single light source, for example, this one fluorophore travels through an optical instrument, it cannot be detected as it is. So the light is basically distributed in a pattern specific for the optical instrument. And this formation of light is called the point spread function and is due to diffraction. And the light that is all originating from a single source is expanding spatially. And the structure will be seen a lot larger than it originally was. So coming back to these two dots and the question of resolving them. So now we learned that these are actually not two dots, but point spread functions, so PSFs. And resolving these two is pretty easy, right? But when we move them more close to each other, this is getting more and more difficult. And this limit by the diffraction of light was actually described by Ernst Abbe, and the formula is carved in stone on the Ernst Abbe monument here in Jena. And objects, and this limit basically describes that objects which are closer together than roughly 240 nanometer in X and Y and 600 nanometer in Z cannot be resolved. And this distance and the formula is defined by the wavelength of the light and the numerical aperture of the objective lens. And techniques that overcome that limit are called super resolution techniques. So we know now how resolution is described, but what is actually super resolution? And answering this is a perfect opportunity to turn to astronomy and the sky. So it turns out that there is a constellation up in the sky that is called Lyra. And within that constellation, there is an epsilon star. And if we take a look at that star with the conventional telescope, what you see is this blob of light on the left side. And if we improve the resolving power of the telescope, you see that this is not just a single star. In fact, there are multiple stars in a cluster. And if we increase the resolving power even further, what we can see is that this is even a double-double star system. And this is exactly what we do if we do super resolution microscopy, improving the resolving power of our instrument in order to see what is actually there, rather than a diffuse blob of light. So super resolution microscopy, or circumventing the diffraction limit in microscopy, was honored with the Nobel Prize in 2014 to one third to Eric Betzig, Stefan Hell, and William Werner. And the Nobel Prize was honored for techniques like Storm, Palm, and Stead. Mats Gustafsson is the inventor of structured illumination microscopy, and unfortunately passed away earlier in 2011 before the Nobel Prize was honored. We will come later to these kind of techniques. First, we need to answer the question, why do we need super resolution microscopy at all? So there are a lot of biological structures which we can study using a conventional wide field or confocal microscopes. So we are able to detect cells in our samples and see large organelles such as the nucleus the endoplasmatic reticulum and the Golgi. But there are many biological structures which are smaller than these objects. And prior to super-resolution microscopy, we would have to turn to electron microscopy to resolve these structures. The advantage of techniques like structured illumination microscopy, SDET, ARI scan, localization microscopy are enabling us to bridge this gap utilizing fluorescence. And this is actually very nice because super-resolution fluorescent microscopy maintains the benefit of targeting different structures with fluorescent tags and giving us even the possibility to do this in living cells. So today I will talk about a couple of super-resolution techniques or techniques that overcome the diffraction limit. And I structured them into point scanning approaches. So confocal microscopy in combination with deconvolution, ARI scan technology and the STAT, and in wide field based approaches. So for example, wide field with apotome, lattice SIM and SIM square technology and single molecule localization microscopy. So we will start with confocal in combination with deconvolution. So this slide illustrates nicely the difference between wide field and confocal microscopy. So in a wide field, the whole field of view is illuminated evenly. Yeah, the emission light from the complete field of view is imaged with the camera with one snap. So you save time, but with thicker samples, the out of focus light is blurring the image and reduces contrast and therefore also resolution. When using a confocal or an LSM, only one focal point is illuminated at a time. So the emission from one focal point is collected. What you have to invest time to scan your sample, but what you get is contrast and a good resolution. Confocal is a word that is derived from the conjugated focal plane. And the most important component of a confocal microscope is the pinhole. And basically, the pinhole is the part that makes the confocal to a confocal. It is placed at the conjugated focal plane in the detection beam path, and the pinhole rejects the out of focus light. So on the right side, you see that the laser light is coming from the right. It hits the MBS, is directed towards the focal plane through the objective, and is coming back passing the main beam splitter. So blue and red dotted lines are coming from out of focus. And green is in focus and can pass the pinhole. And it is important that only the central part of the point spread function, so the ARI disk, can pass the pinhole towards the detector. So the size of the confocal pinhole needs to be matched to the size of the ARI disk. Any smaller and you are throwing out useful light, any larger and you see more out of focus light. It enables optical sectioning. And the confocal is one of the most versatile imaging platform available. So confocal microscopes allow us for you to optically section thick samples, separate multiple fluorophores and do like Yasmina, I think in the first webinar mentioned, do photomanipulation experiment. So this technique is great for multicolor, thick sample, you get a good resolution and a depth penetration. Combining confocal microscopy and deconvolution became very popular in the last years. So, but what is deconvolution and why do we need deconvolution? So deconvolution is a mathematical method which can improve microscope image by the knowledge of its optical properties. Images generated by a microscope can contain, for example, to some extent, blur, noise, and reduce contrast. Some of these effects can be reverted by deconvolution. So this is a quick overview over the history of deconvolution. So initially, deconvolution was a concept for improving transmission of signally and spectral data. And in the late 80s, Agard and Sedat started applying deconvolution to images created with microscopes. And in the 90s, this was picked up by others, leading to a rapidly evolving field of creating 3D data from wide field microscopes or also improving 3D data sets created with a confocal microscope. We as ZEISS entered the market in 1997 with our own implementation of 3D deconvolution as one of the first vendors. So we offer deconvolution since a long time and we are continuously improving it. And one of the latest game-changing technology that we introduced was the introduction of GPU-based deconvolution, which increased massively the speed of processing. So, but how does it work actually? Here we are looking at a picture of idealized microtubule. And these microtubule-labeled molecules actually act like small fluorescent light sources. And each of these light sources behave like a bead or like a PSF, a point spread function. And an image of this microtubule generated by a microscope can, for example, contain to some extent blur, noise, and also reduce contrast and not so idle aspects. And so the image formation is in a microscope is actually illustrated here. So an image is the convolution of an object with the point spread function of the imaging system. So you see here the object, which undergoes the PSF formation and is then, the result is a blurred image of the object. And deconvolution, like I said, is the mathematical reversal of the imaging process. And this leads to an approximation of the real object. And it's critical to the knowledge, so the knowledge of the PSF. So you need to know the fundamental information of the point spread function of the microscope. There are a lot of available deconvolution methods on the market. And this is just a table of different methods. You don't really need to read everything, but I just wanted to highlight out that one of the most used methods is the co-strained iterative method, which is actually the workhorse and the best of overall method that is used. But there are also many others. And this method was used here on an LSM 880 confocal image on the left. So these are mitochondria stained with TOM20. And on the left side, you see the actual image. And on the right side, you see the combination of a confocal image after iterative deconvolution. And what you see is the overall improvement in image quality due to the deconvolution step. And this was achieved by closing the pinhole to around 0.6 ARRI units. And this is one way to improve the resolution in the confocal image. So the normal setting of one ARRI unit will allow for optical sectioning, so hence Z resolution. However, the lateral resolution is not greatly improved by this. So the upper left graphic shows the pinhole opening starting at one ARRI unit. On the right hand side, our graphs show that the connection of open pinhole diameter and lateral resolution at the top and Z sectioning at the bottom. And the lower left image, this one here, is a graphic of the single Z slice. And in the middle are the PSF, the point spread functions in X and XY and XZ direction. When closing the pinhole to lower values, so going under one ARRI unit, the resolution in X, Y, and Z will be improved because the PSF is getting smaller. However, the light density in the point spread function is not changed, and therefore less light emitted from the original fluorescent molecule is used. So the improvement in lateral and axial resolution is achieved by blocking and, as you want to, throwing away signal. When closing the pinhole to 0.2 ary unit, the lateral resolution improvement is at its maximum. And the thinnest Z slice is achieved. But you have to pay this with the currency of photons. Most of the emission light is cut off in lateral and axial direction in order to improve the resolution. So what you see here is that the signal drops dramatically when you close the pinhole. Okay, so now coming to the second techniques where I want to talk about is the ary scan technology. So here you see a comparison of the light path between a standard confocal and the ary scan. Having a pinhole in traditional confocal microscopes and the advantage of ary scan detection without pinhole. And in ary scan, the pinhole is rejected by the single ary scan detector elements. So the size of the pinhole opening dedicates the optical sectioning ability of the system. And effectively, the smaller the pinhole, the better the resolution, but that happens in the expense of light collected, like we discussed before. So the ary scan detector is comprised of 32 detector elements, and each of these actually represent a 0.2 ary unit pinhole opening, but the overall light collection efficiency is the equivalent of a larger pinhole opening of 1.25 ary unit. So as we can see, the field of view, ary scan reads all the 32 elements at a time and forms a super resolution image with a simultaneous increase in signal to noise ratio. So the technology behind ary scan can be divided into four steps. So we use 0.2 ary unit subunit of the detector for best resolution. More signal is collected with the overall opening of 1.25 ary units. We collect the spatial high frequency information in every image and reassigning it in 2D and 3D. And we do a linear deconvolution at the end. With ary scan, we revolutionized confocal imaging. So ary scan increased resolution by the factor of 2 in all directions, so X, Y, and Z. And additionally, and also in my eyes, more importantly, we increased also the signal to noise ratio by the factor of 4 to 8. So you do not need to change as a scientist anything. So sample preparation and labeling stays the same. And it basically pushes confocal imaging to the next level in terms of speed, signal to noise ratio, and resolution, giving you the ability to generate this very nice and quantifiable images and giving you 120 nanometer lateral resolution with only one single image. So resolution improvement in fixed samples is nice, but we know that life out there and of course in cells and in your experiments happens in 4D. So temporal resolution is often as important as spatial resolution. And what we are looking here are actually cardiomyocyte cells that are buckling. And we compare here ary scan fast mode with a resonance scanner, which is promoted as a tool in the field to improve speed. And what we see is a clear difference, right? So we have a bigger field of view, better signal to noise ratio, and a better resolution. And with ary scan 2 and multiplex, what we introduced, we even scaled up more for today's scientific needs. So I just showed you the example with this cardiomyocyte cells. And ARIES-CAN2 and multiplex pushes this experiment even further. So now you are able to image bigger regions with the same image quality, resolution, and increased speed without changing anything. So this animation shows why ARIES-CAN increases resolution and signal to noise. So in the traditional confocal, the diffraction limited laser spot scans your sample. And you need to close the pinhole to get super resolution. And this costs a lot of photons and your emission light. With ARIES-CAN2, you detect all photons of 1.25 ARRI units. You extract the spatial information and calculate a single super resolution image out of that. And this is repeated for every pixel, and this results in a super resolution image. So ARIES-CAN super resolution mode provides immediately enhanced image quality and super resolution for detailed structure information. With the multiplex 2Y mode, you can acquire two pixels at once. So the excitation laser spot covers more than one pixel, and ARIES-CAN2 can extract two image pixels at the same time. And this speeds up your acquisition by the factor of two. This leads to a speed improvement, and this is combined with the increased photon collection that is done by ARIES-CAN and the increased resolution. And this usable speed allows now for gentle live cell imaging of large field of views. So instead of zooming in that we are used to from confocal to a single cell, you can now image all information and draw conclusions from many cells. But we can do even more. So four lines of super resolution image content can be acquired by the same time with the multiplex 4Y mode. So the excitation spot covers more than one pixel, and we extract now four image pixels at the same time. Increasing speed tremendously and still keeping the structure information that you need for your experiments. To show you what this means for your daily life, this is a field of view that was acquired with the ARIES-CAN super resolution mode. If you use now multiplex 4Y mode, you can image a dramatically increased field of view at the same time. And it is even more than a factor of four, because this sampling allows us to reduce the pixel dwell times while keeping linear scanning. So let's put this into perspective and compare this to the options that are on the market and compare it to confocals that offer only deconvolution. So in a normal confocal, in order to increase resolution, to go beyond this classical 240 nanometer lateral, you have to close the pinhole at least to 0.6, 0.5 ARRI unit. And this reduces your emission light dramatically. So sure, deconvolution will improve the image at the first glance. So if we look at the details, we can all agree that the image looks better after deconvolution. But when we compare this to ARIES-CAN2 with multiplex and a four-fold parallelization shown here on the left, with the results you get with a small pinhole and deconvolution, you see a tremendous effect. So the image on the right took 30 minutes to take, and it only takes, and the image on the left, so the Aries scan, only took over 1.5 minutes to collect. And let's scale this correctly. So the Aries scan image captured a much larger field of view. And so just to mention, both images were taken of the same sample with the same laser power measured with a photometer. And when we look at the close-up again of both images, the Aries scan image provides a lot more structure information. So the mitochondrial membrane is resolved in the Aries scan image. For most researchers, the resonance scanner is the preferred tool to improve speed. But the simple reduction of time to collect photons will result in images with almost no information anymore. And compared to the resonance scanner, Aries scan multiplex remains noticeably faster and with all spatial information and a great signal to noise ratio. Okay, so now we are coming to the next super resolution technique, stimulated emission depletion, STET. So STET microscopy uses two laser pulses to localize fluorescence at each focal spot. So the first pulse is used to excite the fluorophore to its fluorescent state. And the second pulse is a modified beam used to de-excite any fluorophores surrounding the excitation focal spot. So the focal spot is raster scanned across the sample to generate an image. So the acquisition speed can be relatively small for larger fields of view. With appropriate dyes, a resolution down to 30 nanometers can be achieved in X and Y. And an interesting aspect of STET is that this donut opening could in principle be made arbitrarily small by extremely increasing the depletion laser beam. And therefore the resolution is in principle not limited. But the typical resolution is given of the order of 50 nanometer to 80 nanometer in Z. So from the perspective of experimental usability, the challenges associated with STET are threefold. So first, you have to design the experiment so the used dyes and labels are within the spectral and photophysical properties of the depletion beam, because not all dyes can be depleted efficiently. Second, you have to maintain a stable and precise shape of the donut over your sample, and you have to adapt depletion beam intensity to minimize the dosage on your specimen. With that, you get a really nice resolution improvement, but STET is generally not considered the most adequate system for live cell imaging due to the high power required for the depletion beam. Okay, so now we are turning from point scanning approaches to wide field based approaches. And the first approach is the apotome. So the apotome is a technique that uses structured illumination. And in this case, we are looking at an image of worm taken with a wide field microscope. And as you can see, because of the thickness of the sample, the structure in this worm appear hazy. One way to get robust and reliable optical sectioning is by using structured illumination with the apotome technology. And as you can see, the apotome is projecting a grid pattern light onto your sample, resulting in an easy optically sectioned image that you can acquire. But for this, you have to invest time in order to collect enough images. And if you want to improve the image quality further, you can also use the apotome in combination with deconvolution. So now you can see the snapshot of a cell image with a normal wide field microscope. And now you can see the structured illumination pattern projected on the image as well as the final apotome sectioned image. And the same image after deconvolution. So you can see the transition from the wide field image to the apotome sectioned image to the deconvolved apotome image significantly improves the resolution of the image acquired. Another wide field based approach is structured illumination microscope and the lattice SIM technology that we introduced a couple of years ago and the SIM square technology that was introduced a couple of weeks ago. Structured illumination microscopy is offered by the ELIRA 7. And structured illumination provides a twofold resolution improvement in all dimensions. So rather than 240 nanometer in X and Y, we can double this to achieve 120 nanometer. So in the wide field image, you see the microtubules are blurred together. And in the ZIM image, we can clearly separate them from each other. So ELIRA 7 and Lattice SIM delivers all the advantages of structured illumination microscopy technology. So you have optical sectioning and the doubling of the diffraction limited resolution in 3D. You have standard sample preparation and no limitations in your choice of fluorophores. It provides an optimal image quality and resolution across the entire visible spectrum with a large field of view. Our novel lattice illumination takes structured illumination to the next level, but let's have first a look how conventional ZIM works in general. So here you can see a series of lines, and let's pretend that these lines are microtubules in the sample. So the important part is that these microtubules are spaced so close together that we cannot resolve them with a conventional microscope. So what we do in structured illumination microscopy is putting a patterned illumination on top of these microtubules and shift it across the sample. In conventional ZIM, this is a stripe pattern. And this leads to the formation of that black swiggling lines. And these lines are called the moiré fringes. The important part of these moiré fringes is that they are spaced more far apart than the microtubules, which means that they are actually resolvable in the microscope. So now we know the spacing of our stripe pattern, and we can resolve the spacing of the moiré fringes. It is a simple calculation to calculate the spacing of the microtubules. And this is how you can achieve super resolution information by using a structured illumination pattern. So with lattice SIM, we change the shape of the pattern of the light. So rather than a stripe pattern, we are using a 3D lattice pattern. So the lattice pattern is shifted over the sample. We still have the formation of the moiré fringes and are able to extract the super resolution information. So in classic SIM, you pass a stripe pattern over your sample, but we actually have to rotate that stripe pattern in order to collect enough information to generate super resolution images. And of course, rotating always takes some time. With lattice SIM, we change the pattern to a series of spots, which is shifted across the sample. So this gives a higher contrast and is more robust for processing. Importantly, there is no need in rotating the pattern. So we save time and the phase shifts are equidistant to each other. So there are many benefits in changing the pattern in addition to that. So in classic Sim, rotating the stripe pattern leads to redundant light exposure, illustrated here in orange, that your sample receives. In Lattice Sim, light efficiency is extremely improved. So we reduce the light dose that your sample receives. In addition, the lattice pattern is brighter than the stripe pattern, providing a much, much better contrast. So you have lesser effects of autofocus blur, and you can achieve better images with better resolution with the same illumination dose. You can maintain the image quality at higher frame rates and image deeper into the sample and still obtain a very good resolution improvement. But why can we image deeper into the sample and still obtain better images? So when we evaluate structured illuminated patterns, we often look at something that is called the modulation frequency. So if we take a look here at the linear Sim pattern in blue, again, the lattice Sim pattern in red, and if we would draw an intensity profile across the sample at 2.5 micrometer sample thickness, we could see the improvement in the signal to noise in the lattice pattern in comparison to the stripe pattern. And this very robust modulation that we see in the lattice pattern allows us to image deeper into samples with an improved signal to noise ratio. To show you what this looks like in practice, this is a color-coded projection of a 75 micrometer thick Z-stack. This was acquired inside an uncleared brain tissue section. And if we zoom in here, we can see that we are still able to resolve spines at different depths of the sample. So close to the cover slip in blue and 75 micrometer deep in red. If we take a look at the same data set in a 3D rendering, you can see the volume of information that was captured in this lattice Sim image with this kind of detail and resolution. So this is an 80 by 80 by 75 micrometer volume that was acquired just in a few minutes. So our platform, Elira 7, with the novel lattice Sim is an extremely versatile instrument. And over the last minutes, I only showed you one mode, so the Sim mode. And with this mode, you achieve a twofold resolution improvement at a very high frame rate, which is already the fastest Sim implementation out on the market. And this is only possible with a lattice pattern and not with a classic Sim pattern that everybody else is using. However, there are different modes that can push this even further, starting with the leap mode. So the leap mode reduces the number of images required for a Z-stack by a factor of 3, giving you 51 frames per second with a twofold resolution improvement. So let's have a look how this works. So when we acquire volume in general at any microscope, what we do is to acquire a Z-stack. We focus on a single plane, take an image and move to the next focal plane and take an image until we acquire the complete Z-stack, right? And this is also how we acquire a Z-stack in the conventional lattice Sim mode. In the leap mode, what you are able to do is actually acquire only every third plane. And from that information, we can reconstruct all the intermediate planes indicated here in blue, providing the same image quality and resolution in Z that we achieve in the conventional mode. And the leap mode allows us to acquire volume 3 times faster or with only a third of the photon dosage. And this speeds up the acquisition of volumes by a factor of 3. This is a comparison of a normal sampled image on the left and a leap mode sampled image. And in most of the samples, you do not see a difference between the leap mode and the standard Nyquist sampling. So to even improve temporal resolution further, we introduced the burst mode. And this burst mode achieves up to 255 frames per second with a twofold resolution improvement. And the burst mode is a sliding processing algorithm which generates more processed frames from the same raw data. And this is a post-acquisition processing mode and increases the digital frame rate in the final time series dramatically. But how does it work? So in conventional mode, 15 phases are required to generate one frame. Phase 16 to 13.1 are used then to calculate the second frame. By applying the burst mode, we are continuously acquiring phases. So and calculate from phase 1 to 15, frame 1, phase 2 to 16, frame 2, and phase 3 to 17, frame 3, and so on. Increasing the time resolution up to 15-fold to 255 frames per second. But what does this actually mean? So let's assume that the green and the red boxes are different events in your sample. In the conventional mode, we could not resolve them because the movement would be during one frame, so in frame 1. In the burst mode processing, we can clearly separate them from each other due to the sliding processing algorithm. So the green box, the green event, would lie in frame 3, and the red event would lie in frame 4, for example. So this is a side-by-side comparison of the same data set. On the left is the standard process, and on the right you see a burst mode process. So you can clearly see the improved time resolution in the burst mode process data set. So the left movie shows the stop motion characteristics, where the burst mode process movie is very smooth. So now we can see events that were previously missing. And this novel burst mode is only possible due to the lattice illumination and the equidistant time intervals. Summarize this up. Lattice sim comes with a lot of benefits. So you can image faster, you can image more gentle with less bleaching, image deeper into scattering samples, and get better images, so better resolution with the same illumination dose. So the ELIRA 7 also offers an apotome mode, and this is the ability to acquire rapid optical sectioning on the ELIRA 7. So in wide field, as we discussed already, we often suffer due to autofocus blur or background signal. And these effects decrease contrast and resolution. And the apotome mode on the ELIRA uses structured illumination to give you fast optical sectioning with great contrast and high lateral and axial resolution. So this works with a grid pattern, acquiring 5 images with different grid positions. And this grid is used to illuminate and rapidly modulate the fluorescent signal in the focal plane. So this apotome mode allows you to perform fast and gentle lifestyle imaging, or you can use your optical sectioning speed to increase your productivity when acquiring large sample areas over big volumes. So this mode provides nearly isotropic resolution. So if we take a look at the X, Z, and YZ planes, we can see the excellent sectioning capabilities of this mode. In fact, what you can achieve is 180 nanometer lateral and around 330 nanometer axial resolution. This is a data set of a Penicillium fungi, which is really showing very nicely the capabilities of this mode. So like I said, we are using a linear grid. So 5 phases are required with up to 51 frames per second. It works with very, very huge field of views. So you can use a 10x objective, 20x, 25, and 40x objective. And you have an overall improvement of resolution by a factor of 1.4. And you are extremely fast in acquiring the images. So with the Lyra 7 and Lattice Sim, we push versatility extremely far. So we offer this kind of 4 different modes. So 3 acquisition modes, leap, apotome, and Sim mode. And that we discussed, and the additional burst processing mode. It enables the user to perfectly match the achievable spatial and temporal resolution with the specific scientific needs and the applications. But we did not stop here. So a couple of weeks ago, we introduced the new Sim Squared technology, bringing Sim to the next level, achieving a 4-fold resolution improvement. But how does this new algorithm work? So first, let's take a look at the conventional Sim reconstruction. So the sample here is imaged with the microscope, acquiring different phases and images. These phase images then undergo Sim processing and deconvolution, which is done in standard Sim in one step. So the microscope PSF is used for the whole process. But Sim processing itself also affects the image, and conventional Sim image reconstruction cannot correct for these effects, since the Sim processing and the deconvolution happen in the same step. So we address this weakness of the conventional Sim image reconstruction, and in Sim squared, processing and deconvolution are 2 separate algorithm steps. In the software, of course, this is only one step for convenience. So while performing the Sim processing for the image, exactly the same processing is also applied for the point spread function. And with this, we generate a Sim PSF, which reflects all effects of the Sim processing. And we use then this very Sim PSF for the iterative deconvolution. With Sim squared, we can demonstrate now that we can resolve structures well below 100 nanometer resolution, actually down to 60 nanometer, not only in technical samples, as shown here, the DNA origami, but also in real biological samples. So here you see a comparison of a Lattice Sim and a Lattice Sim squared result of the same data set. And already from the first view, we can clearly see that in the Sim squared image, the structures are much finer. But if we now zoom in and take a look at the fine details, we will see the striking difference between Sim and Sim squared. So Lattice Sim squared easily shows distances of 60 to 70 nanometer between microtubules, while the same structures are clearly unresolvable when using structured illumination processing. But actually, this is not all. So one major advantage of structured illumination microscopy over other super resolution techniques is the ease of use of multicolor imaging, right? So ILIRA 7 enables us to image up to 4 colors in the same sample. And I'm showing you here the synaptonomal complex. And this is a well-known biological structure, a protein structure that forms between homologous chromosomes during meiosis. And comparing structured illumination microscopy and Sim squared processing unveils that we can use the multi-channel image to detect distances below 50 nanometer between different channels. While this arrangement can clearly be seen in the structured illumination in a Sim squared image, in the classic Sim image, it is not possible to see this arrangement. Okay, so now we are turning to techniques to single molecule localization microscopy techniques. And for those applications that require even higher level of resolution, the system offers actually localization microscopy with up to tenfold increase in resolution. So 20 nanometer in XY and 50 nanometer in Z. So thanks to the dual link adapter on the ELIRA 7, equipped with two cameras, this can be done simultaneously with two colors. So in this sample, the microtubules are labeled both with alpha and beta tubulin with two different dyes. And when we zoom in, we can untangle those microtubules if they are crossing each other. And we see that each epitope can only be coupled by one of them. Of course, this can be done also in three dimensions. So ELIRA 7 allows you to image a very large capture range in Z. So here displayed in color-coded projection, and the capture range actually in Z is 1,400 nanometer over a large field of view. And if we zoom in, we can untangle the microtubules in Z. So localization microscopy is more than just palm. So there are a lot of techniques available. So paint, lobster, de-storm, palm, and many others are actually very similar to each other. And this slide is a 3D image of a mitochondrial membrane in kidney epithelial cells acquired with the paint technology. And in paint, blinking is generated by the transient hybridization of short DNA, single strand coupled to a fluorophore. And with this complementary strand attached to an antibody targeting the structure of interest. So you see this kind of blinking after this. So with ELIRA 7, you keep the advantages of localization microscopy. So the tenfold increase of the resolution along all three optical axes and the large number of available fluorophores. So the information about the number and the distribution of molecules, as well as single particle tracking acquisition. But how is localization microscopy achieved? So instead of exciting and acquiring the light from all fluorophores in the field of view at the same time, which actually leads to a diffraction limited or wide field image, in localization microscopy, only light from a subset fraction of fluorophores is emitted and acquired at a time. This allows the individual molecules to be precisely located below the resolution limit. By acquiring a sequence of several thousand images and subsequently mapping the precise position of each detected molecule, a final super-resolution image can be generated. And typically, a precision of 20 nanometer. That means a more than tenfold resolution improvement can be achieved. The capture range in one single plane is around 1,400 nanometer in Z, with an axial resolution of 15 nanometer. Okay, so with that, I'm coming to the end. So I talked about a couple of super resolution techniques. There are tons of other techniques available on the market. So we talked about point scanning approaches, and we talked about wide field approaches. And I'm happy to answer or try to answer your questions.